Trophy. It took Georgia Tech extra innings to get to this day, thanks to the heroics of Nomar Garcia-Pera. While Oklahoma rode the strong left arm of Mark Redmond to get to this moment of crowning glory. Today, Georgia Tech meets Oklahoma for the championship of the 1994 College World Series. As usual, we expect a full house here at Johnny Rosenblatt Stadium. The city of Omaha, Nebraska is always a glitter this time of year, and why not? The two best teams in college baseball have come to decide a national championship. Today, it's the Yellow Jackets of Georgia Tech against the Oklahoma Sooners. Not a bad day as we approach game time here in Omaha. Temperatures in the low 70s with high humidity, but only a 10% chance of rain. Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to Omaha. I'm Greg Gumbel, and we are always excited as we get ready to crown yet another college baseball champion, Georgia Tech against the Oklahoma Sooners. Both of these teams have come through their respective brackets unblemished. Out of bracket number one, the second-seeded Yellow Jackets, a perfect 3-0, and the same can be said for the Oklahoma Sooners, champions of bracket number two. They're also at 3-0. Joining me here in the booth today, longtime friend, former manager of the Mets, the Chicago White Sox, and the Cleveland Indians, Jeff Torborg. Let's first talk about Georgia Tech, Jeff, and an outstanding athlete behind the plate in Jason Varitek.
Well, they're a good ball club. Their game is based on power hitting, good pitching, and they're led by a three-time All-American, Jason Varitek, who's also the National Collegiate Player of the Year this year. And he's not just the only star in this club. They've got three other All-Americans. This is a ball club that relies on a home run, 91. That's 24 more than Oklahoma's hit. So it's a very solid ball club.
Now, speaking of the Oklahoma Sooners, their heart and soul is a second baseman who swings a pretty good bat and plays some good defense.
He really does. He symbolizes what the club does. It plays a speed game. It's good defense and clutch hitting. He's an All-American as well. He leads the club in RBI and stolen bases, and they're a club that also is deep. They've had seven guys drafted last week in the Major League Draft, so they're solid as well.
If Rick Gutierrez has a good day, so will the Oklahoma Sooners. We have the field well covered. Leslie Visser is down there today, as well as former University of Miami coach Ron Frazier. Let's check in right now with Coach Frazier. Coach?
Greg, a little scouting report on both ball clubs. Oklahoma coach Larry Cashell brings a lot of college World Series experience here. He's brought three different schools here, a World Series record. He's an aggressive coach, he likes the running game, and they have a solid defense. And if his pitcher, Lovinger, can take them five or six innings, he can turn it over to Bucky Buckles, one of the best relievers in the country. Now, in Georgia Tech, Coach Danny Hall is making his first appearance here at the College World Series, as well as his team. Hall is more of a station-to-station coach who relies on the long ball. Pitching and power at the plate have brought him here. The key to this ball game may be Jason Varitek, if he can stop the running game of Oklahoma. Leslie Visser, take it over.
Coach, you're absolutely right about Oklahoma. Larry Cashell would like five strong innings, then turn it over to his ace reliever, Bucky Buckles, one of the great names in college baseball. Well, as for Georgia Tech, they'll go with the rangy right-hander, Al Gogolin. Gogolin is loose and confident. He's even a bit of a screwball. His own teammates call him Nuke after the theatrical pitcher Nuke LaLoosh in Bull Durham. Coach Danny Hall told me that although Gogolin isn't overpowering, he said in this situation he wants someone who can handle adversity, and that will be Gogolin. One note, Oklahoma starting third baseman MJ Mariani came down with food poisoning last night. He had some bad shrimp primavera. He was in the hospital until 4 o'clock this morning. He told me he's weak and dehydrated, but he's going to try to go.
Here's how the Georgia Tech Yellow Jackets will look in their lineup. Leadoff man is shortstop Nomar Garcia-Pera. Batting second, switch hitting second baseman Scott McIntyre. The number three hitter is junior center fielder Jay Payton. Behind the plate, the cleanup hitter, switch-hitting catcher Jason Varitek. The number five man in the order is junior third baseman Brandon Hensley. He's followed by sophomore first baseman Scott Byers. The designated hitter is Michael Sorrow. Out in left field and hitting eighth is junior Michael Smith. And another junior out in right field, Matt Sayer. Defensively, this is how the Sooners look. Eric Thomas is in left field, Chip Glass in center, Darvin Traylor in right. MJ Mariani getting the start at third, Rich Hills at short, Rick Gutierrez at second, Ryan Miner is at first base. The catcher is Javier Flores, and the pitcher is Kevin Lovinger. And Kevin Lovinger will look at Nomar Garciaparra to get things started. 7-2, 2.89 earned run average, a great curveball, and not bad as a power pitcher either, Jeff.
No, from what we've heard from the coaches, he's got a real live fastball.
There's a call. Strike, and we're underway.
That looked real live. The catcher dropped the first pitch.
Garciaparra, 4 out of 15 here in the College World Series. A 428 hitter on the year with 15 homers and 72 runs batted in. There's the breaking ball, and that missed, and the count is even at a ball and a strike.
Greg, we talked to Larry Koschel yesterday. He said he'll get a read on this young left-hander right away. With his kind of stuff, they can see it right away whether he has it.
Hit sharply in the hole between short and third, and the first base hit of the game belongs to Garciaparra. Our umpires for today's game, calling the balls and strikes behind the plate, is Dick Runche, Dan Peterson at first, Bob Nelson at second, John Magnuson at third. Tim Henderson is down the left field line, and Bill Davis down the right field line. Garciaparra on at first base, and here's Scott McIntyre. Garciaparra is Georgia Tech's team leader in stolen bases, 33 out of 42 on the season.
Greg, we talked about Oklahoma being a running ball club, and Georgia Tech relies on the power, but this is one guy in their lineup, Garciaparra, that they will run with.
And they pitch out. 1-0. The Oklahoma catcher, Javi Flores, is a shortstop by trade. That's called strike, 1-1. He came to Oklahoma, and Larry Koschel said, I need a catcher. And so Javi Flores, although he'd like to return to his regular infield position at some point down the road, said, sure, I'll give it a shot. And here he is behind the plate in the College World Series championship game.
I watched him play the other day. I guess it was on Thursday. And I didn't know that he had been an infielder, but I watched his moves. He had very quick feet. And I said, you know, that's what you usually look for in a shortstop. We get here and find out, yes, he had been an infielder.
That's inside. 2-1.
You know,
you, of course, a believer that all catchers have quick feet.
Oh, yes. and very bright minds. But they just done something here. They're trying to keep the runner close at first base, but you hate to see a left-hander show his move twice so early.
This one hit in the air, short center field. Hills is out. Coming on is Chip Glass, and he makes the catch. Here's Jay Payton, hitting 286, 4 for 14 in the College World Series. A great 435 average on the season. Jay Payton leads a pretty good lineup, doesn't he? Jay Payton, Garciaparra, and Jason Veritek.
102 RBIs in 60-some ball games. That is amazing.
That's at the plate and low. The count is now 2 balls and no strikes.
Greg, when you have hitters like this coming up in the middle of your lineup, you better make sure you pay attention to the hitter. They're paying an awful lot of attention to the runner at first base, and that's when you get hurt. If you're messing around over there too much and don't make a quality pitch.
That's foul down the right field line, 2-1. As Coach Frazier said at the top of our telecast, Danny Hall plays station to station, and Garciaparra, for as well as he runs, has not yet attempted a steal in the College World Series.
Yeah, so you want to make sure that he doesn't. But when you have guys that have the offensive numbers that Georgia Tech has in the middle of their batting order, you've got to make sure you're concentrating on the right spot, and that's at home plate.
That misses, and the count is now 3 balls and 1 strike. We talked about his RBI production. Runs, RBIs per game, second only to Hofstra's Mike Miller. This Oklahoma team is very adept at turning the double play. There goes Garciaparra, and he's picked off. Throw down to second, and he's out. Kind of a surprise to start things off here.
It is a little bit. Looks like they want to show that they're aggressive. He went on the first move, the left-hander, and the left-hander just picked him off. He had kind of lulled him asleep a little bit.
The flip over and Ryan Miner's throw down to shortstop Rich Hills is absolutely perfect. And Peyton follows this down the right field line, and the count is now full at 3-2.
If you get picked off like that, it's a good thing to do is just keep right on flying, because they made that play pretty close. If the left-hander takes a little time getting it to first base, the play can be very close at second.
And he got him swinging, dropped at the plate. Flores will throw him out, and that'll do it for the Yellow Jackets. Here in the first inning, they get a hit. They do not score. We'll go to the bottom of the first. Scoreless. Welcome back to Rosenblatt Stadium. This is the lineup for Larry Koschell's Oklahoma Sooners. Junior left fielder Eric Thomas is the leadoff man. He's followed by right fielder Darvin Traylor. At second base, Rick Gutierrez hits third. The cleanup hitter is designated hitter Damon Miner. Shortstop Rich Hills bats fifth. And then it's center fielder Chip Glass. Third baseman MJ Mariani hits seventh. Damon Miner's twin brother, first baseman Ryan Miner, hits eighth. And the freshman catcher, Javier Flores. Defensively for Georgia Tech, Michael Smith in left. Jay Payton in center. Matt Sayer is in right. From third to first, it's Brandon Hensley. Garcia Pera is at shortstop. Scott McIntyre is the second baseman. And Scott Byers over at first. Behind the plate is the All-American Jason Veritek. And on the mound is, as Leslie Visser pointed out, Jeff, a character in Al Gogolin.
Yeah, I hear he's the practical joker, but the guy comes to play. We talked with him yesterday. He's very serious about how he wants to pitch this game. He's a fastball, slider, and changeup pitcher. He said his slider is his out pitch, but when he talked to us, he said he's going to pitch in a lot. I look back at the stats. He's hit 10 guys. I guess he does pitch in a lot, but they also say he's got the ability to hold this Oklahoma team close at first base, which is a big, big plus for them.
Here's Eric Thomas, who is still looking for his first hit here in the College World Series. 302 hitter on the year, but 0 for 7 since he's arrived here in Omaha. Shows bunt, takes it on the outside corner for a called strike.
Of course, the best way to combat a running team is to keep them off the bases or score a lot of runs so you take the running game away. But that is a concern of the Georgia Tech club.
Oh! Gogolin tried to get at the same spot and missed, and the count is even at 1-1. This one followed back 1-2. As you mentioned, we were talking to Al Gogolin. We were talking with Jason Veritek, and we're saying, boy, they're big guys. They look like they could be football players.
Both of these clubs are pretty good size. When you look at the twins on the Oklahoma club, the Miner brothers, they're monsters, 6'7".
Nothing minor about them.
Okay.
In the hole between short and third, that's hit number one of the College World Series for Eric Thomas. And the Sooners have a man aboard. Gogolin stayed on the outside corner, and Thomas went with it. Now, contrary to Danny Hall's station-to-station philosophy, these Sooners will run, and it's a pretty interesting setup here. Jason Veritek against the base-running Sooners.
It really is. Well, watch how he's going to vary his stops. He's going to try to be quick to the plate. He has a slide step in his repertoire where he doesn't lift the leg. We'll see how he handles this.
Oh. That's inside, 1-0. To Darvin Traylor.
What you see, Greg, is the first base coach for Oklahoma will have a stopwatch and will check to see how quick Gogolin is to the plate from his first move to the catcher. And then they'll have a good read on how they can run.
Thomas over at first base is 23 out of 29 in the stolen base department.
Okay, there's that other look that he gave him. He threw over by stepping back off. So he's going to show them a lot of different looks over at first base to keep them off balance.
Gogolin excels at keeping runners close. There have been 8 stolen base attempts against him in 136 innings this season, and Eric Thomas was going to give it a shot there.
That looked like a hit and run. I tried to get him on the watch to see how quick he was. He was very quick to the plate. But by the way, Traylor's hoying at that ball. I think that might have been a hit and run.
Traylor has been on base half the time that he's come to the plate here in Omaha.
Well,
move to first, and Thomas is back in on his belly.
Now there's a completely different move. That was a jump move over to first base. So they're pulling out all the stops early. They're trying to show them what they have and try to keep them close for Jason to get a chance to throw.
Bottom of the first inning, each team with a hit. We have no scores yet.
You know, a running game can really disrupt the defense. You can see they're paying so much attention to the base runner that it can really affect your defense. The defense is on their heels now. The pitcher stepped off a lot of times. It can affect the offense as well. You know, the hitter standing in there a lot waiting. But it can affect the whole defensive alignment.
That's called strike. Count of now ball and two strikes. Oklahoma has run quite well since arriving here in Omaha. 9 attempts, 7 successful. And as you say, just to say that you're going to run gives the pitcher a whole different attitude on the mound, even if you never take 2 steps. That's a fair ball down the first baseline. Extra bases for Traylor. Larry Koschel is going to wave his man around. He will score. Oklahoma has the lead. The throw to third, and Traylor is in with a triple.
Well, we said earlier that he was going to try to pitch inside. And on this ball, he tried to get it in there, and Traylor just turned on it. Left-handed hitters usually hit the ball down and in better, and that's where that ball was. So he got it inside the first base line.
First baseman Scott Byers just one step too far away from the bag. It got between him and the bag, and Oklahoma leads it 1-0 here in the first inning.
If you're going to pitch in, you're going to pitch up and in. You don't want to get it down and in.
Here's Rick Gutierrez. 350 hitter on the year, 10 home runs, a team leading 65 runs batted in, and a .583 batting average here in Omaha. He is 7-for-12.
You know what's interesting about this Oklahoma ball club, their 2 leading RBI men are their middle infielders. You don't see that very often.
This one the other way. It'll get the run home out the second. McIntyre to Byers. And that's the first out of the inning, and Oklahoma leads it 2-0. Good job of hitting by Gutierrez.
You're right. That's good team hitting. They're giving the run. They're playing the infield back, and they're giving him a run on the ball on the ground, and he didn't try to overpower the ball with a chance as you pop it up. He took what they gave him. They got the run in. That's playing inside baseball.
Here's the Oklahoma DH, Damon Miner, just shy of 300 on the season with 13 homers and 50 runs batted in. Those 13 home runs lead the Sooners. That's high and away, ball one.
Greg, I saw him hit a ball here the other day that went not only over the stands out here, but it was way down in the parking lot. This is a big 6'7" kid. We watched him take batting practice yesterday. He is strong.
This one fouled back. He lost a couple yesterday.
Yes. So it's a nice blend. You've got the speed at the top of the order, and then you've got the big guy in the middle. You've got a couple guys that can pop the ball. They don't have the power potential, it seems, or at least the numbers that Georgia Tech has, but they've got a nice balance.
Wide open stance at the plate for Damon Miner. A pretty good cut at that one and fouled back. No, I beg your pardon. It wasn't a home run. It was an 11. This one chopped off the foot of Miner at the plate.
You know, when you look at this inning, you wonder how much the base runner really did bother Govlin, because he spent so much time trying to keep him close, and he had 2 strikes on Traylor, and he wasn't able to make the pitch he wanted. And that, again, is what often happens in the back of the lineup if you have guys that can run in the front end. You get a lot more fastballs and also maybe pitches that you can hit better.
In on his fists, up the first baseline, and Govlin makes the play for the second out. Georgia Tech with a 2-0 victory over Cal State Fullerton. Then beat Florida State 12-4 with an 8-run 10th inning. And then beat Fullerton again.
You know, Greg, it was funny. That ball that big guy hit didn't go very far. In baseball, they're probably yelling from the dugout. It's not carrying to right today. That ball looked like it stuck to his back.
That's called strike to Rich Hills. That's about as well as you can jam a hitter with an aluminum bat.
Yes, I think so. He said he was going to pitch in, and that was what they say way in the kitchen.
Hills takes that outside. It's 1-1. Rich Hills, 4 out of 11 here in Omaha for a 364 average. A 344 hitter on the year. That's called strike 1-2.
Dogan looks like he's throwing the ball a lot better out of the full windup.
Came inside the Hills and evens the count now, 2 balls and 2 strikes. Hills, a junior shortstop who can also catch. 2-2 pitch, line down the left field line. Fair ball, kicked up the chalk. Hills makes the turn at first, and he'll pull in the second with a two-base hit. As Michael Smith wheels it into third, that is the third hit of the inning. Another runner in scoring position now for the Sooners.
Well, Rich Hills is one of the drafted players, and he was talking to us yesterday saying that he has been told that maybe he will be switched position, but he's got the kind of body. Boy, he got the head of that aluminum bat out on that ball. Gogolin's throwing the ball well, and he popped that ball. He got the head out, and that ball hit right on the line. But he was saying he might have to change the position if he gets into pro ball. They think his body is going to get a little bit bigger.
Here's Chip Glass, the center fielder, takes ball one.
Greg, he hit a home run the other day. Now, you can see how, if you look at the picture, how much he chokes up. He hit a ball into the teeth of the wind on Thursday here, right out of this ballpark. It was really surprising.
Glass has 2 home runs here in Omaha, one of them an inside the park job, and the other the one you talked about, and he's one of the big sluggers that Oklahoma brings into Omaha. 750 slugging percentage or better for Gutierrez, Glass, and Traylor. 1-1 towards short. Garcia Parra will throw him out, and the Yellow Jackets are finally out of the inning, but not before Oklahoma registers a couple at the end of one. It's the Sooners, 2, and Georgia Tech, nothing.
Great rides. Geico Motorcycle. See how much you could save.
We welcome you back to Omaha in the start of the second inning. Oklahoma with 2 in their half of the first with a 2-0 lead. It'll be Jason Veritek, Brandon Hensley, and Scott Byers for head coach Danny Hall. And here is the young man about whom a lot of people are talking. Great numbers. And Kevin Lovinger's first pitch is a breaking ball that comes up short and way inside, 1-0.
You know, Greg, something that's really impressed me about this guy is that he was a first-round pick last year and negotiated hard and long and went back to school.
And he hits this one a mile to left center field. Goodbye.
Wow, that was in the light towers over the top of the speakers.
Of the season for Jason Veritek, his second here in Omaha. And Georgia Tech cuts the Oklahoma lead in half. It's 2-1. He got it up way too high, Jeff.
He sure did. He's a high ball hitter right-handed, definitely, and that ball was out over the plate up right where he could see it, but boy, he really hit that ball.
Swinging on the first pitch is Brandon Hensley, and this count is 0-1.
what I started to say about Jason before was that he was a first-round selection and came back to college and got even put bigger numbers on the board. That's tough to do after the year he had a year ago.
1-1 now to Hensley. Veritek, Baseball America's Player of the Year. The winner of the Dick Houser Trophy. There's a drive into right center field. Traylor on his horse and is there to make the catch. And as the ratings go for Baseball America's all-time All-America team, they figure there is no catcher better than Jason Veritek.
Is that amazing? That's really saying something. Somebody's still playing.
And look at the names.
Robin Ventura.
On this list. Rafael Palmeiro. Here's Scott Byers. The breaking ball from Lovinger misses, and it's 1-0.
You know, you mentioned Dick Houser Trophy. Dick Houser was a good friend, and I coached for him with the Yankees, and what an outstanding baseball guy, and tragic, too short a life, and it's wonderful that that trophy is named for him.
That one skips into the plate, and it's 2-0.
Invariably, after a home run, you'll see a pitcher walk a man. Well, he didn't walk the next hitter, but now he's being a little careful here.
That catches the outside corner, and it's 2 balls and a strike. They were telling us yesterday, Kevin Lovinger, they didn't think he was tough enough in his first years, and then for some reason or other, he decided to get down to business this year. He got tougher. He was out of the rotation. He pitched his way back in, and by his own admission, he says simply, I finally grew up.
Well, that happens. You're talking about kids. We're talking about these kids in the College World Series.
And there's that base on balls you were warning about.
Yeah, and the reason for that is a guy will sometimes press after a home run. Now that home run should have counted for two. That's how far that one went. But I think what it does, it knocks the psyche loose. But he got the next hitter out, but then he walked the left-hander. And that happens a lot with left-handers as well because they try to be careful out over the plate. But I think you just mentioned about Lovinger. I think he just matured. As they were talking, he just got older and he got bigger and he felt much more confident in what he was doing.
Here is the designated hitter, Michael Sorrow. Michael hitting 244 on the year, 3 out of 10 here in Omaha. And time has been called. And Vern Rule, the pitching coach for Oklahoma, is going to go out and talk with Kevin Lovinger. If you are wondering, it is the one and the same, Vern Rule from Major League days.
Boy, he was a good pitcher. I first saw him in Detroit, and of course, then he went to Houston, had an outstanding couple seasons there. They're concerned about Lovinger. We talked yesterday with Larry Koschel that they can read him pretty quickly. When he starts to get banged around a little bit, they know he's having a little trouble. He's got the kind of action on his ball that if he keeps it down, they don't hit the ball well. But now he's been up in the zone. He just walked a hitter here, and this is, hey, there's no tomorrow, so they're warming that bullpen up. They're not going to stay real long with any pitcher today.
Larry Koschel said one of the reasons why he wanted to go with Kevin Lovinger today is to turn Veritek around and have him hit from the right side.
That's right. That's exactly what he said. Well, maybe left-handed, he hits him farther. I don't know.
You saw the Oklahoma bullpen up and working already. And the count now is 2-0 to Sorrow. You know, going back to Vern Rule for a moment, one of the guys down on the field yesterday was saying if the Oklahoma hitters start to get big-headed, Vern gets out there and throws, and he can still do it. He'll get them out and sends them away from the plate shaking their heads.
Yeah, he was a good pitcher, knows how to pitch. I'm sure that's he's been able to teach this Oklahoma staff how to set hitters up and how to come at them. But right now he tried to calm this young left-hander down. He's a little shaken right now.
3-0 pitch. 3-1. Lovinger, strong, big and strong, good fastball, terrific curve. This ball 4. So Tech with runners now at first and second.
You know, this is a big inning for Oklahoma because normally what you try to do in baseball, when you've scored, you try to shut the other team down immediately because it's a psychological advantage. Oklahoma scored 2 and bang, right back comes Georgia Tech with a big home run and now 2 runners on base. And this is the type of inning that you have got to stop right here.
Lovinger has thrown 27 pitches, only 11 of them strikes. There's a call, strike to left fielder Michael Smith. Runner out at second is Scott Byers. Michael Sorrow is on at first, and now Javi Flores is going to go out and talk. The Yellow Jackets can score runs. They are second in the nation among Division I teams, only to Memphis in runs per game.
It's always good time to score runs anytime you have a chance to. But when the bottom of your order does it, if they can come through now with their eighth and ninth place hitters doing some damage here, that'll really pick their spirits up.
Lovinger taking his time to go to second, and the relay doesn't get the double play.
That looked a little strange. It looked like maybe he forgot how many outs there were, and all of a sudden it occurred to him. But he was making sure of one out. They teach constantly, make sure of getting one out, but he hesitated too long. He had a double play ball here.
1-1,000, 2-1,000.
Yes.
We mentioned in the previous inning, this Oklahoma team has done a tremendous job of turning the double play this season. There's ball one.
Both these clubs are very, very strong, very well-coached teams, and they're strong in their fundamentals. That's a surprise to see that. We watched them take pitchers fielding practice yesterday just doing that same thing.
That's a called strike. One and one now to Sayre. Just misses on the inside. Two balls and a strike.
You know, when you're out on that mound or you're catching behind the plate, you look in the on-deck circle to see who's on deck, and you do not want Nomar Garcia-Pera coming up and with the bases loaded.
He's within a ball of doing that now. The count is 3-1 to Matt Sayre. Here's Garcia-Pera in the on-deck circle. With the count full and two out, Michael Smith will be off with the pitch at first.
You can see Javier Flores sitting right behind the middle of the plate. He wants Lovinger to throw that ball right down the chute right now. He doesn't want to mess around picking.
Got him swinging.
That's a big strikeout.
The home run by Jason Varitek, the only run on the board. 2-1 Oklahoma. We'll return to Rosenblatt Stadium after this message and a word from your local station.
Morris Motorsports is Oklahoma's largest multi-line motorsports dealer, and we're growing even bigger. Can-Am Spyder is here. Trucks are arriving daily, so come see our huge selection of new Can-Am Spyders at our state-of-the-art 40,000 square foot showroom, like the Can-Am Spyder RS with traction control, ABS, and Brembo brakes, or the Spyder RT built for touring with its vehicle stability system and iPod-ready audio system. Plus, test ride before you buy. We're making great deals at Morris Motorsports, just minutes away in Chickasha.
Did you ever lose your keys, ask someone else to help look, and there they are, right in front of you? Well, if you're looking for a job or the right employee, that's why we're here. OklahomaCityHelpWanted.com. Employment is all we do. It's the only thing. We help employers find qualified local candidates. Looking for a job? Post your resume for free. View job listings in your area. We promise it's there, and we can help you find it. OklahomaCityHelpWanted.com. Long name, amazing results.
Here's MJ Mariani leading off, the third baseman for Oklahoma. And Gogolin's first pitch is high, ball one. Mariani, as Leslie Visser reported at the top of our broadcast today, bout of food poisoning. Up most of the night, feels weak. But as you said, Jeff, you only play in a College World Series championship game.
You're right. Right. One time.
Once every so often.
Not too often. A
couple of times if you're lucky.
But I'll tell you, my experience has been some of the guys who have been the sickest have had the best game. And the reason for that, I don't know. Maybe you're more relaxed. Maybe you're focused more. You're not as hyper. Wait and see. Let's see what happens here.
2-1 pitch inside corner. 2 balls and 2 strikes. Interesting, too, because we heard just before the game that MJ Mariani said the bat felt like a tree trunk to him downstairs.
Well, we were talking yesterday with Larry Koschel. He'd like to see him get started in the stance a little bit earlier, and that might be a psychological thing he has to do. I think he has to get going a little earlier.
He's barely got around on that one. Down the right field line, the count stays at 2 balls and 2 strikes. Oklahoma with 2 in the first. Eric Thomas a single. Darvin Traylor tripled him home and then came in on a ground out to the infield. Count is full now to Mariani. And in the top of the second inning, Jason Veritek hit one out in left center field, which is due to come down within the next 5 or 10 minutes or so, I would think. Full count pitch. Ball 4. Take a look at that Yellow Jacket pitching staff and what it's done in the postseason. 75 strikeouts in 80-plus innings.
It's tough to get much better than that. Pitching is usually what sets the tone and what really wins the ball games, and that's what both of these coaches here today are really thinking about. They're going to try to manipulate their pitching staffs the best they can to get through this.
Here is Ryan Miner, twin brother of designated hitter Damon. Ryan is the first baseman on this team.
Ryan is, from what we heard yesterday, NBA basketball potential type player. He's a real good player.
Averages 18 a game for the Sooners basketball team. That's called strike.
Yeah, it's funny, Greg, the other day I was watching this game on TV, and the phone rang, and as I'm watching the game, I see this great big guy, Miner, come up and hit left-handed. And all of a sudden, I see a right-handed Miner come up to hit. I didn't realize they had twin brothers on the same team, and I'm thinking, why is the guy hitting right-handed against a right-handed pitcher?
You better go easy on that iced tea. That's a called strike. 1-2. Because of the basketball, Ryan Miner did not arrive for the Sooner baseball team until mid-March, so he had a late start. Chopper over the middle. Back of second, the play made by McIntyre and the double play. Good job by Scott McIntyre, who fielded the ball behind second, stepped on the bag and threw on to first.
As we're watching the replay here, I thought he missed second base the first swipe at it with his foot, but we'll see here. Yes, he did, and he came back for it. Wait a minute, he never touched it. I thought he missed it the first time.
Okay, he thought about going back and getting it.
Yes, he did, and then he realized it was too far away. He couldn't make the throw if he went back.
Down to second. McIntyre fumbles it, picks it up. What an interesting inning for Scott McIntyre out at second base. And eventually, despite the walk, the Sooners go in order. We played 2 here in Omaha. Oklahoma 2, Georgia Tech 1.
Indulge in the luxuries of London. Stay on par in Paris. Feel the rejuvenation of Rome while tasting cuisine from here to Cairo. It's the magic of Madrid. The bustle of Beijing, the vibrancy of Vienna, and more energy than New York, all in one place. It's a world apart, but not a world away. WinStar World Resorts.
It's a chance to gather with family and friends and create memories that will last a lifetime. The real value is in those memories. For membership information, contact The Trails at 364-3790 or go to our website, trailsgolf.com.
Back in Omaha at the College World Series, I am joined by a former college pitcher, also the executive director of the NCAA, said Dempsey, welcome to Omaha. You've just extended the contract to play in Rosenblatt through the next century. Why is that?
Well, we've agreed in principle to continue it through the year 2000. Well, Omaha's been great for college baseball, and it's been a good marriage between the NCAA and the city of Omaha, and as we've seen the growth of it, and I've been coming back here for, I've been here since the early 80s and even in the 70s, and to see what's happened with the interest and the growth in the game is really great.
On another topic, the International Baseball Association last week rejected a proposal to allow professionals to play in the 96 Olympics. How do you feel that we will not have a dream team in Atlanta?
Well, the USA Baseball really favored it, and I think it was more of the Latin American countries that were able to boycott doing it this time around. I'm not sure that's going to be a dead issue before it's all over with. I think the major problem, obviously, it occurs during the time of the regular season of baseball, and how to adjust to that would be certainly a problem in this country.
Well, we'll see. Thank you very much, Seth. Enjoy the game. Back to you, Greg.
All right, Leslie. Seth Dempsey said it perfectly, didn't he? It's been the perfect marriage. Omaha has been great for the College World Series and vice versa.
Greg, this is my first trip here, and I have never been to Omaha before. With all the years I've been in baseball, and I've heard so much about it, and boy, they really welcome folks here. This is a nice setup.
Two balls, no strikes, and that one's hit deep to left center.
That they had outstanding power. And there's their shortstop popping one out. That's two runs on two home runs. That Oklahoma dugout doesn't feel real good about having the game tied, but they could also have envisioned they were one pitch away from him hitting with the bases loaded. Here's the replay. That looked like the same location pitch that he hit out the other day for a home run, out over the plate a little bit. And down. Nice looking stroke.
Nomar Garcia Pera. Nomar is his dad, Ramon's name, spelled backwards. And it's his middle name. His first name is Anthony, but Nomar says, I'm not an Anthony. I'm more of a Nomar.
He's also a darn good player.
Oh.
He was the 12th pick overall in the Major League Draft last week.
And Larry Koschel is going to make a change right here. Sean Snyder, number 42. Is the pitcher out of the bullpen for Oklahoma.
Larry Koschel told us yesterday that he would go to Snyder right away if there was any problem. He said he throws strikes. He can sit for weeks and then come in throwing strikes.
Scott McIntyre is the hitter, turning around now to hit from the left side against the right-hander. Left-handed, he hits 339 as opposed to a 260 average from the right side. And that's on the outside corner, 2-1. Strike 2-2 now. Kevin Lovinger not real pleased with his outing today.
No, that's a big honor to start a game like this, and to be out so soon has to hurt.
Count is full now to Scott McIntyre. That's fouled off. We'll do it again. Oklahoma with two in the first. Georgia Tech has bounced back with the home run ball. Jason Veritek hit one in the second. Nomar Garcia Pera here in the third inning. This one down the left field line and will fall out of play.
You know, a lot of times ball clubs and fans don't give the bullpen enough credit. They think of the starting rotation, they think of the closer. The guys in the middle are the ones that can really pick you up in difficult times. And this bullpen right now for Oklahoma could be the key to this College World Series game.
This one hit in the air to left field. Eric Thomas with plenty of room for the first out of the inning. That'll bring up center fielder Jay Payton. Jay,
Jay Payton was taken by the Mets. I was talking to Joe McElvain the other day of the Mets, the general manager, and he mentioned they took this young man, and it's almost like a first rounder. It's a sandwich pick between the first and second rounds. Good looking player.
And a shot past third down the left field line. Two bases for Payton as he pulls into second, standing up with a double. That ball was past MJ Mariani almost before he could react.
It really was. Now you can see why he had 123 hits this past season. Can you imagine a college team having three guys with 100 hits? He went down and almost got that ball off the ground. That was a P. Mariani didn't even see that ball. That can be tough on a hot day like this with a shirt sleeve. Sometimes you don't see the ball.
And Jason Veritek is about to get a free pass as he steps in from the left side.
Well, they might boo. The crowd might boo, but this is a very smart move.
He leads Georgia Tech in bases on balls with 74 of them on the season.
Well, by walking him here now, with a ground ball, they can possibly get a double play. The other way, they might have seen one. He looked like a better hitter to me in batting practice, hitting left-handed than right-handed. But then we saw him hit it right-handed today, so maybe left-handed they go farther. I'm not sure.
The scary thing is, maybe he is.
I know. I'm semi-kidding.
Here's what Veritek did back in the second inning.
Well, here he's real short. His hands are close, real short. And pow, this ball's up in the zone, and he got it.
Veritek, a 443 hitter right-handed, 413 left-handed.
Sounds like a real weakness to me.
What a drop-off. Here's Hensley. Flied out to right, back in the second inning. Two on for Georgia Tech. One out, one run in on the home run by Garcia Parra. That's a call strike.
Well, when you compare these two clubs statistically, Hensley has got 65 RBIs, which would tie for the lead, I believe, with the top of Gutierrez of the Oklahoma ball club, and he's about fourth or fifth in line on his own team.
Popped up. At first, Ryan Miner pulls it in. Big out for Sean Snyder out on the mound. That's two down now and brings up Byers.
Well, Greg, you and I stood behind a batting cage yesterday and watched this young man Byers swing the bat. Scott Byers can hit. He's got a sweet left-handed stroke, and he was popping them out of here regularly yesterday. So Mr. Snyder has his work cut out for him here to get out of this situation here and not allow a tweener or something that would score a couple runs. Try to save that run at second if he can as well.
Outside corner, strike one.
That's a nice pitch. Normally what you talk to your guys about, when you see a left-hander, he's kind of your typical left-hander, likes the ball down and in. You say to your guys, stay out of that low and inside zone. You can pitch all over the rest of the zone, but stay out of that area. And that's what we saw him hit yesterday.
No balls and one strike to Scott Byers. Side, one and one. Garcia Parra started the inning with a shot into the seats in left center field. Snyder came on and got McIntyre to fly out to left. Payton doubled down the left field line. Veritek was walked intentionally. Hensley fouled to first. Two on, two out, one and one to Byers. Two and one.
Snyder has a count right now where you're even with a hitter. When he was down a minute ago, I didn't think they'd go anywhere near his power, and they got it, made a nice pitch in location there. But you know, each one of these pitches now in a count like this, in a game like this, is very important, even though it's this early, because this is an emotional roller coaster, especially in a game so highly charged as this.
Two pitches outside, the count is full, the runner goes, the throw down. Maybe not the wisest decision in the world by Jay Payton to try to move up. But Georgia Tech gets one on the homer by Garcia Para, and we're tied at 2.
I came to the University of Oklahoma as an 18-year-old in 1965. That's only 17 years after the first African-American students enrolled at Oklahoma. The University of Oklahoma provides so many opportunities for involvement in the arts and theater and athletics. I want to provide that same opportunity for other young people who are looking at choosing a career and deciding what they want to do in life. This is just a very special place, and it holds very special memories for me.
People are wondering where they can still find free checking. It's as easy as finding your nearest Arvest Bank. Our free blue checking comes with lots of features. A free debit card, free online and mobile banking, overdraft coverage options for when your account gets low with a fee that's about half what most banks charge. And since it's from Arvest, you'll have the freedom of more than 230 locations and 8-to-8 banking. Free yourself from fees. Switch to free blue checking from Arvest Bank.
Bottom of the third inning for Oklahoma. It'll be the top of the order. Eric Thomas, Darvin Traylor, Rick Gutierrez to face Al Goglin, who finds himself dead even once again. High ball one.
You know, this game is so different with this aluminum bat. I was just, of course, listening to Ron speak about how they throw a lot of breaking balls here. And
taps one down the third baseline. The bunt attempt is going to be successful. And Hensley could not make the play. And that'll go as a base hit.
I'm surprised if it's closer to the line, you'd think he had more of a shot at it, but I think he rushed it just a little bit.
So for a guy who was hitless here in Omaha, Eric Thomas has had himself a pretty good day so far. Singled and scored in the first, and a bunt single to lead off here in the third. And here is Traylor, whose RBI triple began the scoring. Chopper over the middle, runner on the move on the play. Garcia Parra's play is to first. And Thomas is out at second. Here's a chopper over the mound, and Garcia Para takes it. He had no play on Thomas at second. When I said he was out at second, I mean he's standing out at second.
Yes, okay, I'll accept that.
Eric Thomas is safe out at second.
I don't know whether that was a hit and run or whether they were running and hitting there, because they do like to run, as we said earlier. Swing kind of was not the swing that we're used to seeing for Traylor. He's got that short, quick swing, and it looked like he was just trying to put the ball in play. It might have been a hit and run.
Gutierrez right back to the pitcher, Goglin. And now hung up between second and third is Thomas, and he is out.
Well, they executed that rundown very well there. That was... Actually, when you get in a rundown like that, if the Oklahoma player was able to just keep that thing going for a while, they would enable the runner to get to second base. But Georgia Tech played it perfectly. Hensley ran him back, got him moving, then got him stopped. Good play.
Garcia Para makes the tag. Incidentally, official scorer has ruled that is not a bunt single. They had charged Brandon Hensley with an error.
I thought it was an error. I thought he took his eye off the ball just for a minute right after Gogolin went past him. Hensley kind of looked up like he was looking at first base, and the ball went off his glove. Now this is an interesting situation. You've got the best base stealer for Oklahoma on base right now, and they're going to try to go for it somewhere quick early in the count, I would think.
Ground ball to short. McIntyre makes the play.
Jinning.
Everybody is off the base pass, though. We're tied at 2 after 3, and we'll return to Omaha after this message and a word from your local station.
Austin and Sylvia are engineering students at the University of Oklahoma. They receive scholarship funding from OU graduate and President's Associate donor Claire Tran, who, as an OU student, received a scholarship from Lawrence G. Rawl, who also earned his degree at OU. It's not a trend. It's a Sooner tradition. OU President's Associates, Sooners for Life. Visit givesooner.ou.edu to support this generation of Sooners.
Singing, oh, 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 it's beautiful. With low prices on everything your family needs, Academy Sports and Outdoors has more ways than anyone to take it outside. Right stuff, low price, every day.
Welcome back to Omaha. Top of the fourth inning, Georgia Tech and Oklahoma tied at 2-2. And for Tech here in the fourth inning, Scott Byers, Michael Sorrell, and Michael Smith to face the new pitcher on for Oklahoma, right-hander Tim Walton. And just as I mentioned to you during our commercial break, Jeff, looks like Larry Cushell isn't going to spare anybody today.
No, there's no tomorrow, boy. They're going to let it all fly out here.
First pitch lined in the left center field. Glass on the run. Best speed on the team. He hooks it down.
Looks a little like Lenny Dykstra running after that ball with a glove on the right hand. Walton's another one of the kids from California. Larry has really recruited very heavily in California, and most of this club, or most of his starting members of his club, I think at one point, of the 15 guys that played in the World Series, 10 of them were from California.
Here's Michael Sorrow, walked back in the second inning.
You know, I was watching the game the other night, or the other day, I should say, on Thursday, it was earlier in the week. Michael Sorrow's father pitched for Tech years ago. And I think he was a very successful pitcher, but gave up a home run in the ninth inning to lose a regional. He still naturally feels it, never forgotten it, but his son hit a home run that day.
His son bounces one down to short, but he did a nice play by Rich Hill.
Not the day that his father pitched, that day. I mean, the day I was watching.
Are we correcting ourselves a lot so far today? You mentioned watching the game earlier in the week. It reminds me of our usual tip of the cap to our colleagues at ESPN who do such a fine job broadcasting the College World Series. From its beginning and up until the time that we come in here. Hit in the air, center field. Here comes Glass. Tim Walton makes short work of Georgia Tech here in the fourth. Three up and three down. We'll go to the last of the fourth inning, tied at two.
When you're driving, we all know it's a lot easier to get where you're going if you have a GPS. Looking for a job or the right person for a job? That's what we do. Oklahoma City Help Wanted.com. For years, all we've ever done is link employers with the right local candidates and people looking for jobs with the right local employers. When it comes to jobs, we're like your very own GPS. Oklahoma City Help Wanted.com. Long name, amazing result.
It's been days and you're still not unpacked. You've been busy, very busy, with all your Cox services installed, ready to go when you moved in. It was easy, seamless, high-speed internet, TV, digital telephone. So many movies to stream, so many TV shows, so many downloads. You did call into work, didn't you? Move with Cox and get free professional installation and a 2-hour service window. Moving made easier.
Back in Omaha at the College World Series, while reflecting the true meaning of student-athlete, two Georgia Tech players missed their graduation ceremonies this morning in Atlanta, but their diplomas were flown here to Omaha, and they recreated the ceremony in the hotel. Second baseman Scott McIntyre, reserve outfielder Matt Barr, along with student trainer Shane Rose, have completed their degree requirements. They, of course, would like to cap off today by winning a championship NCAA ring. Greg?
Leslie, thank you. Scott McIntyre said the two things you work hardest for all through school, one is graduation day, and the other is to get to the championship game of the College World Series, and they both fall on the same day. Congratulations to them.
That's outstanding. That's a great story. I've got a son who's graduating next Saturday from Northwestern, and in between his last exam and graduation, he's out trying out for the Dodgers in Vero Beach.
There's a drive into right field. Playing it was Matt Sayre, took off and over his head, and Hills pulls into second. That's what you call a ball with some carry.
I'll say that's aluminum bat line drive right there. Of course, you're seeing it lately in the major leagues. They're saying the ball might be juiced up, but that ball just kind of looked like it had a second takeoff because Sayre looked like he had a beat on it, and all of a sudden he realized, uh-oh, I'm in trouble. That's a lonely feeling out there.
Another half step and he would have been there.
Oh, boy.
And here's Chip Glass. Hills is on its second. And we're still waiting for a ruling. It would strike me that that'll go as a two-base hit.
Oh, I think that's got to be a hit. That ball just took off. He didn't lay leather on that at all. Remember what Goldblum said yesterday? He said Oklahoma will come out hacking, he said. Then he corrected himself. He said, no way, that's a bad golfer. He says, they'll come out swinging. He's right. This club keeps coming at you.
Well, they have charged Matt Sayre with an error on that play out in right field.
Let's see how much I know about this game.
So Hills is on at second. Glass stands in 0 for 1 with a ground out to short. That's a ball 2-1.
Yes, he's the kind of hitter that would be a real good turf hitter, too. He can run real well. He puts the ball in play. Some of those pop-ups, those fly balls to the outfield are too easily handled.
Georgia Tech pitching has been tough in the clutch. The opposition is 0 for 16 now with runners in scoring position. But here is yet another opportunity. There's a base hit to left. Hills will hold at third. And runners at the corners for Oklahoma with nobody out. Glass with a shot through the hole.
Yeah, he waited for that ball. He just stayed back. He wasn't overcommitting. He was going to just try to shoot it through. Normally in that situation, you'd like to see your guy pull it to the right side of the infield in order to move the runner up. But with the way their club slaps the ball around, I think that Larry just lets them go aggressively to hit the ball where it is.
Glass with speed on at first. And here's Mariani, who walked to lead off the second. Let's see what Larry Coschell has in mind. The inning started with not an innocent line drive to right. It was a rocket misplayed by Sayre into a two base error. It's inside 1-0.
Now this is a situation here that you might have a double steal situation because you have a real good base runner at first base. So it'll be interesting to see how Georgia Tech defends it. If they do go, whether Veritek will throw through or they'll have a trick play on.
There goes Glass. Swing and a miss. Veritek does throw through, but he's in there.
Yeah, we're watching the replay now, and you can see that that ball is right on MJ's hands. That is a tough pitch for you to throw. The ball that's over to his glove side, he has to pull it back to him and close his front shoulder. And yet Jason made a pretty good throw. It's a little high, but that if the ball's on the other side of the plate, it keeps you close and it's easier to throw. But the one that's inside on the hitter, he also had to wait back to make sure he didn't swing through it and hit him. So he had to wait back and then close up. So we'll take another look at it here. Now he glanced at third base and made the throw to second. If the throw's down, I still don't think he would get him, but that's a tough thing on a that is the most difficult play for a catcher, because if you have to look at third base before you throw to second, that hurts as well.
Glass now 4 for 4 in stolen bases here at Omaha. Two balls and a strike now.
I'm sorry, Greg. We watched them work out yesterday. If you remember, they were working on first and third defenses. And one of the things they wanted to make sure was that they looked that runner at third back. So basically, they were playing that safe there. Another way to defend that play is to throw through, and just if the runner is way off third base, the third baseman raises his arms where you can see out of the corner of your eye as a catcher.
There's a base hit to center field. At least one will come home. Peyton comes up throwing. The throw to the plate. He's out. No, he's safe. Veritek looked like he made the tag, but plate umpire Nick Rungy said he was safe. And Danny Hall going out to the mound wants to know if he made the tag or not, and now he's going to come back to the umpire.
From here, it looked like he tagged him, but you don't umpire from here, but one of the things they have to do is calm this young man down. He's a key to their ball club. They can't let him be ejected.
Danny Hall Cashel looks like he wants the plate umpire to ask anybody else.
Here's a throw coming to the plate. He gets it in time. Oh, he definitely tagged him. And the problem you see is the umpire, where is he? He's a little bit out of position here. He gets behind the runner. Well, from the angle where the umpire is standing, it looked like he missed him. He was kind of over on the first base side.
And I don't know that any of those replays are conclusive at all, but the first time that I saw it, it looked to me as if he was tagged.
I thought he tagged him. In the first replay I saw, it looked like his shirt moved, that he tagged him up around the waist, just above the waist. That one right there, he tagged him. As you can see him making the, he's tagging the uniform underneath his arm.
And as you said, considering where umpire Dick Runchie was, it's impossible for him to see that.
That's right. From where he was when we saw the angle, and this good camera work, guys, you can see that from that position where he's standing, it looked like he missed him.
Let's take one more look.
Here we go.
From center field.
It's strange, isn't it? From there, it looked like he missed him. Inconclusive is the call here. And MJ Mariani's food poisoning doesn't bother much right now.
No, it doesn't. Ryan Miner takes it inside, ball one. And by the way, it's worth noting that Chip Glass ran through a stop sign at third base on the play.
Well, years ago, Pete Reiser used to tell me he was trying to stop Willie Davis, and he'd have his hands up trying to stop him, and as Willie crossed the plate, he'd just clap right in that same position above his head.
Swing and a miss. Delayed steal, and he's out. Mariani went halfway to see what would happen. And you can't take your time on Jason Veritek.
No, sir. He's got a good, strong arm.
Chris Myers throwing in the Georgia Tech bullpen.
Boy, he's up early. He's a race out of the pen. But as we said, how many times? No game tomorrow.
1-1. Outside, two balls and a strike. Well, just as you get one strange inning under your belt, another one comes along. Down to third. Hensley recovers. Too high.
You know, Greg, that's one of the great things about baseball. It doesn't matter what level it's on. You can be in the game for 30 some years and see something new on the field of baseball. It's amazing. I've done some broadcasts with CBS Radio, and I've seen the darndest things happen this year.
Hensley, his throw was in time to get the runner, but it was high. And by the time Scott Byers came down, Miner was across the base.
Yeah, he's having a rough day out there. That ball just, that would hit him right in the glove.
The bunt by Flores. Gogolin. Ball safe at first.
On the replay, take a look at Gogolin. Look away from the ball. And when he reached for it, he reached down full-handed and his hand stuck in the grass almost, if we could get a shot of it. Now watch him as he goes to field the ball. His head comes off the ball, and he just reaches down and kind of jams his hand into the ground.
Yep. Didn't make a clean pickup in his throw, and it looks like Byers came off the base.
That's what speed can do to you. Speed can make you rush.
So Flores with the bunt single. I'm telling you, this has been an inning. It began with Rich Hills lining it to right. Matt Sayer misplayed it into a two-base error. Then Chip Glass with a single. It put runners at first and second. Glass then stole second. Mariani's single to center brought home the two runs and the argument at the plate. And now Eric Thomas, and the throw down to second goes into center field. The runners move up to second and third.
Well, the defense is coming apart a little bit, but that can happen. You know, it can happen especially when speed is forcing it to happen. Let's watch Veritek get in position to throw this. He's a very aggressive catcher and wants to throw on the ball. Actually, it hooks away from Garcia Parra. It was one of those that
he kind of pulled it across his body. It was like a slider, and the ball went to the shortstop side of second.
Varitek has 9 assists during this College World Series, but has also been guilty now of 3 throwing errors. Runners at second and third. That's a called strike.
Now you can look at the defense. Now you don't see this often in the fourth inning when you have 2 runners on that the infield is playing up. You're almost giving up 2 runs if this base hit gets through because they're playing up close, but it's a College World Series game, and Danny doesn't want to give up any more runs. Oh.
Thomas holds off.
I should say it's not just a College World Series game. It's a college championship game, so they are really playing. They don't want to give up another run here.
Oklahoma, 4 runs, 6 hits, no errors. Georgia Tech, 2 runs, 4 hits, 4 errors. And 3 of them here in the fourth inning. Runner down to third is Ryan Miner. Out at second is Javi Flores. This one hit into left field. Michael Smith with the dive and made the catch. No! But it's a fair ball. And one run has scored. And it's a base hit. I'm telling you, there are things happening in this inning that make you shake your head.
Well, that was almost a sensational catch. The run would have scored from third anyway, but the ball kind of bounced loose behind him, and Javi Flores couldn't tell whether he caught it or not, and the umpire's call was out at first. He called it out initially, and then he called it safe after he saw the ball scoot out from under his arm. Here's
and
the replay.
It is certainly a fair ball.
Yes.
No question about that, and then Smith slid into foul territory and lost control.
Right. The umpire had to wait to the last minute. He called him out to begin with, and then he saw the ball sliding under him and called him safe, so Javi Flores at second had to go back.
Michael Smith may be told when he gets back to the dugout, you return the ball to the infield, then continue your conversation with the umpire as to whether it was fair or foul. It's a 5-2 Oklahoma lead. Miner scored on the play. Flores is at second, and Eric Thomas is now at first base. And this is Darvin Traylor.
Greg, if you remember yesterday at the press conference, the players on both teams, when asked questions, constantly talk about defense and the defensive plays being the key to this game. And they might be right. They're both teams are very aware of the inside game and the solid defense that they need to play to win.
2 balls, no strikes. Ball 3. And if Al Goglin is shaken up on the mound out there this inning, you can hardly blame him.
You're right. When you give him extra outs, and now he's got to make extra pitches, and it's hot out here today, and then the emotion is involved, you get tired.
That's a strike, 3-1. An error, a single. A stolen base, a single. An error, a single. An error and a single.
You were talking about repeating yourself, weren't you?
That's ball 4. The bases are loaded.
Now, when a guy gets tired, when a pitcher gets tired, very often he doesn't lose his stuff. He loses the ability to locate the ball, to throw it where he wants. And that might be the case with Al Goglin right now.
That's Chris Myers in the Georgia Tech bullpen. So Oklahoma with a 3-run lead and a chance for a bunch more.
Well, Oklahoma's got the guy at the plate that they want to hit. He's their All-American.
Gutierrez is 0-2 so far today. Ball 1. Bases are loaded. That's Javi Flores down at third. Eric Thomas is at second. Darvin Traylor at first. 1-0 the count to Gutierrez. Ball 2. And now Goglin is high.
And he's tired. Now the key. And Danny Hall is heading to the mound right now. I don't know if he'll stay or change him right now. Tough spot to change, bring another pitcher in, but he's doing it. He's got to have a lot of faith in Myers. Now the thing for Gutierrez as the hitter, he has really got to focus in on the pitch he wants. He's got to narrow his where the ball is to be.
He'll be facing a different pitcher when we come back to Omaha in a moment. Here's Chris Myers on in relief of Al Goglin. His first pitch misses, ball one.
Wow, what a spot to be put in now. 3-0 with
or ball three, rather, excuse me.
Yeah, well, 3-0, yeah, and you've got the bases loaded. Coming out of the bullpen, that's tough.
That's ball four.
You know, Greg, I was also looking at their stats. He pitched Wednesday night and pitched four innings in relief. And that's only 2 days rest. That's, wow. You want to see, but of course, they're all saying he got a long time to rest.
That walk is charged to Goglin. 6-2, Oklahoma. As Flores comes across the plate and the ninth man to hit in the inning, the designated hitter, Damon Minor.
Boy, is this kid dangerous. If they get a strike down in the zone to this young man when he's up in the count, let's see one really go.
Here's a called strike on one. Damon Minor has not hit well here in Omaha, just 2 out of 17.
Guy this big with the kind of power he's got, though, all it takes is one mistake by the pitcher and he just gets into the ball.
That's inside. 1-1. You'd be the judge on this call. Jason Veritek asked.
No,
the third base umpire.
Good call. Normally, by the naked eye, you can't see the darn thing, and the umpire is almost always right, but the replay indicates he held up.
Rip foul. How many of you have this attitude that the umpire is almost always right?
Well, only over the air.
Sooners everywhere. That's Eric Thomas at third, Darvin Traylor at second, Rick Gutierrez on at first. Damon Minor with a ball and two strikes. Tech would love a double play ball. There's another foul pass first.
What Coach Ron was talking about needing to break the ball. They've been all fastballs at this guy to this point.
Pops a foul, and it looks like it'll reach the seats.
And he's been on almost every one of them, except the first pitch he took on the inside part. If he has a good off-speed pitch here that he feels he can get over, he's not afraid of bouncing, it would be a time to throw it, I would think.
Three errors in this inning for Georgia Tech, four for the game. Coming into Omaha, Tech averaged just over one error a game. Four games here in Omaha, they've committed 11.
Yeah, this has been an ugly inning for them.
A ball and two strikes. Fastball again. This one outside. 2-2.
Well, we're getting to a critical part of this count right now. Two. If he goes 3-2-2, three and two, you know he's going to throw a fastball. The only time he might throw an off-speed pitch would be right now. Except Veritek in this situation might be afraid to call his breaking ball. It might be one of those coming in cold. Might be one of those who would bounce.
Got him swinging.
That was something with a little downage. I don't know what that pitch was, but the ball looked like it had a little dive to it in the outer part of the plate.
First strikeout by a Georgia Tech pitcher today. A little downage is right.
Yeah.
And he swung over the top of it.
You know, a catcher really has a feel for his pitching staff. In a lot of situations like this, he knows the personality of the pitcher, and he might be afraid to call something that normally has to be down in the zone.
Hills fouls it at the plate. Hills began this inning, what, about a week ago?
Seems like it.
With a line drive to right that Sayre misjudged, was charged two-base error, and that began this circus, which will forever be known as the bottom of the fourth inning. Rich Hill's parents cheering him on. Half swing, and it's 0-2.
You know, you don't, I didn't realize until my boys started playing. Sitting in the stands watching my guys play, I was more nervous than any time ever that I played, coached, or managed. You want them to do so well, so badly, because they want it, you know. And you see the agony on the faces of Rich Hill's parents.
No balls, two strikes. Good stop by Veritek.
Now, this is a big at-bat here, too, for the pitcher to get through, because a lot of times when you have a runner at third base in less than two outs, you think, I've got to get a strikeout in this situation, and you relax a little bit. You still need this last out. Need it badly, so he can't mess around here. He's got to make his pitch.
Georgia Tech defense has been on the field a long time, and that one hit him on the wrist, and that brings another run home.
You remember the press conference yesterday, and afterwards we were interviewing some of the players. That's what worries a manager or a coach. When you do a lot of pitching inside, you're very concerned that something like this can happen. There's the ball in, and it hits him in the arm.
Right off the left forearm.
And the thing you worry about, when you teach your pitchers to pitch inside, you say normally you pitch in. If you're going to miss, you miss farther in. And that's what happened right there.
7-2 Sooners. Here's Chip Glass. A base hit earlier in this inning. Ball one. The Yellow Jackets trying to stop the bleeding.
Go here, but boy, that Tech dugout is hoping to get out of this right now without giving up any more.
Myers had Hills 1-2 and then hit him. 1-1 and the count now to Glass. Meanwhile, do you wonder about the effect on Oklahoma pitcher Tim Walton, who went down during this inning and threw a couple of pitches in the bullpen, although he's back in the dugout now?
Yeah, that's always a concern when you bring a guy in, you have a big inning, and he had just gone down to warm up and then came in and had a quick inning, and now he sits down, he has a real long inning sitting down.
1-2 pitch hit sharply, but at second base, the play is made for the force, McIntyre to Garcia Parra. Georgia Tech finally out of the inning. But Oklahoma puts five on the board and leads it 7-2 after four.
Yeah.
I've tried all the usual companies. I've
called around for auto insurance quotes, and
it seems like they're all the same.
If you want a company that feels different the very first time you call, then try Amica.
There has to be something better.
I'm starting to lose hope.
Don't be so dramatic.
It's a catastrophe.
You just haven't called Amica yet. Our whole company is dedicated to great customer service and helping you save money. For example, you can save up to 25% when you insure more than one car with Amica.
I want a car insurance company that's always looking out for me.
We want special attention.
I want to feel the commitment, the dedication.
But where are you going to find a company like that?
Hey, why don't you call Amica? That's a great company. Amica!
Yes, listen to that guy, bicycle guy.
Well, who haven't we tried yet?
You haven't called Amica.
Amica.
Call Amica now for your free, no obligation quote. Check us out online, do a search. We're on Facebook and Twitter.
Back at the College World Series, where Oklahoma has exploded for a 7-2 lead. Well, one of the most emotional stories of the past 2 weeks has been that of Arizona State coach Jim Brock, who is battling liver cancer. He left the College World Series last Tuesday and has been hospitalized in Arizona ever since. Everyone here wants Coach Brock to know that our thoughts and prayers are with him and that he has given college baseball a season of courage we won't soon forget. Greg.
Indeed he has, Leslie. Thank you very much. And we send our best along to Coach Brock as well. Brought another fine team to Omaha here. You had a relationship with Coach Brock. He sent one of his coaches, one of his guys to you, didn't he?
He sure did. He was a coach that I had met many years ago when Bobby Winkles first left Arizona State to come to the Angels as a coach first and then the manager. We played some exhibition games against Arizona State in the spring, and I met Coach Brock for a while and then followed the successes of their teams. But, boy, have they had some great teams over the years.
Two balls and a strike to Matt Sayer. Ball three.
Now, here we are back again, Greg, to the key here. They've got a
five-run lead, and you cannot mess around. You have to throw strikes here. You can't walk anybody. You know, they I say it many times, but they put the inscription on the manager's tombstone that the walks killed them, and you can't defend the walk.
Full count pitch. Hit sharply. Right at Hill is it short. Five runs scored by Oklahoma in the fourth inning. Only one was earned. Oklahoma has scored seven times here today. Coming into the action today, Georgia Tech had allowed just a total of six runs. Look at that. There's a little toe action from Nomar Garciaparra. Off the fist, out towards second, Gutierrez makes the play.
Let's talk about that hole in that shoe. Baseball players are the most superstitious people in the world, and I am right at the top of the class with that. Either he had a blister there and he cut it open, but I think that's an old shoe that he has dragged when he's thrown the ball or when he's going up to the plate.
He just likes it.
And he's been so successful, he's not messing around with it. I remember years ago, I was in college, I was leading the East in hitting, and I changed my shoelace and went about 2 for 28. It'll never happen again. But guys who played with me after that said, you must have had shoe problems all your career.
The Georgia the Georgia Tech crew is a superstitious bunch.
Are they really the whole team, huh?
And you know what? It's getting about that time where they better call on all of their little tricks of the trade. 1-2 now the count.
That's right. I remember reading something about the star made with the bats and the rally hats and the rally hair and all that stuff. Tell you, when you're in that dugout, boy, you'll try anything to get some runs.
McIntyre fouls it back. He stands in 0-for-2 today with flyouts to center and then to left.
Greg, years ago, I guess it was 1989, we had a real bad team in the White Sox when I was managing. But we came out of the All-Star break and we won 8 straight, lost to Roger Clemens, won 3 more. And I wore a rubber jacket. I wore a rubber jacket the first day after the All-Star break because it was cold in Chicago. And we continued to win. We ended up in Boston. I had a rubber jacket under my uniform. I had a radiator overheat. Well, I'll tell you, my eyeglasses were full of water and I was over by the water fountain, but we were winning. I couldn't change.
1-2 pitch. Got him swinging. The play at first will make it 7 straight Yellow Jackets that have been retired. We're halfway through. Oklahoma leads at 7-2 and will return to Rosenblatt Stadium after this message and a word from your local station.
The time has come for the passion, the drama, the pursuit of history. The 2014 U.S. Senior Open is coming to Oklahoma and historic Oak Tree National, July 7th through the 13th. Come see golf's greatest champions compete for our national championship. Daily tickets are now available and are selling fast. Purchase yours today at 2014USSeniorOpen.com or at any iPhilex or Uptown grocery locations.
You need your car whenever you need your car. That's why at Safe Auto, we're here to help keep you going. On the phone if you need a friendly voice, online, or with our mobile app. The right car insurance for the right price, whenever and wherever you need it. 24/7, day and night. Because what drives us, drives you. Safe Auto. Call, click, and enjoy the road ahead.
Team has always been one of the highlights of College World Series history. Good ball players from that club.
Boy, they have some great teams. I got a story to tell you about the 84 team in a minute.
Strike one.
My oldest son, Doug, played at University of North Carolina. North Carolina had stars like B.J. Surhoff, Scott Bankhead, Walt Weiss, Matty Marullo.
This one in the air. Deep to right field, continuing to carry and against the wall. Matt Sayre makes the catch.
Well, now that makes you realize that before, when that ball shot out there, that might not just have been misplayed. That ball might have carried. That, I mean, just might be some wind currents out there that affected it. But anyway, I was getting back to that story, and that same year, the University of North Carolina beat Georgia Tech. We'll take a look at this replay first. He drifts with it, takes him right into the fence.
And Sayre stayed with it well.
He stayed with it all the way, yeah. get this story out.
This is Ryan Miner. Go ahead.
But anyway, the North Carolina team won the ACC championship against Georgia Tech. They go to the Starkville, Mississippi for the region. Mississippi State has Palmeiro, Will Clark, Jeff Brantley.
That's down to third, and Brandon Hensley makes the play for the second out.
And Bobby Thigpen, and you think, wow, one of these two teams have to win this region. They're both sensational teams. The University of New Orleans won that region and went to the College World Series. What was that worth all that effort trying to get that one out, I wonder?
I was taking notes, yeah. Two up and two gone here in the last of the fifth inning, and here is Javi Flores. Ball one. Flores with a ground out in the second. A bunt single in that weird, weird fourth inning. 2-0. And the count now runs to 3-0.
You know, we were talking earlier about how a ball club that's got good hitting, and normally it's in the middle of your order at the front end. If the bottom end of your order, 7, 8, 9 guys can make some things happen, it really helps the ball club. And of course, in that inning, that's the bottom of the order did the damage. MJ Mariani did a super job. This kid got a base hit. You know, at the bottom of the order really can hurt you.
Nub town to first. Meyer takes it unassisted. And after the strange fourth, the Sooners go in order here in the fifth. We've played five complete, and Oklahoma leads it 7-2.
It's a new day at Chesapeake.
With new opportunities.
A new focus on our values.
We're striving for continuous improvement.
Inspiring ideas.
Creating the next breakthrough.
Maximizing our every potential.
We are finding new momentum.
New efficiencies.
Together.
Because the world we live in tomorrow
depends on the difference we make today.
We are stronger.
We are ready.
We are Chesapeake.
Welcome back to Omaha as we go to the sixth inning. The thunderstorms, which rolled us out of bed earlier this morning, have cleared away, and there is nothing but blue sky and warm temperatures as we move to the top of the sixth. Scott McIntyre making the last out of the previous inning, and it's Jay Payton, Jason Varitek, and Brandon Hensley to face Tim Walton. Ball one. In the air, left center field. Glass calling and makes the catch. Oklahoma scored twice in the first inning. In a wild fourth. Georgia Tech had solo home runs in the second inning from Jason Varitek, and in the third from Nomar Garciaparra. Here's Varitek hitting now from the left side. Ball one. Skips that one in. It's 2-0. Varitek hitting from the right side back in the second inning, hit a long home run and was walked intentionally in the third.
Doesn't look like they want to get much to hit here either.
That's inside, 3-0.
He's got a little different stance from the left side. He's open a little and he's spread out a little bit more, as you can see in this picture here. But Oklahoma's not going to put anything right down the middle of the plate, I don't think.
And Varitek is on with a base on balls. His second of the game. This one unintentional. And Brandon Hensley, the number five hitter. 5 through 9, the Yellow Jackets are hitless in the lineup. Garciaparra has two hits. Payton has one. Varitek has one. And that's been it for Tech.
Sit there as a manager in the dugout and you think, you know, wow, I'm going to sixth inning here, and they've got some guys that can pulverize the ball, and you just hope they don't get too many guys on in front of their big pop guy.
Here's a shot in the left center field for a base hit. Veritek takes the turn at second. He'll go to third, and Georgia Tech with runners at first and third, and nobody out here in the sixth inning. And the Tech boosters make a little noise. Make it first and third and one out here in the sixth.
And here's Hensley, gets the ball down, keeps his head down, and hits a bullet over the shortstop's head. Georgia Tech has been a little bit dead in the last couple of innings. I mean, it takes your heart out of you just a little bit, but now all of a sudden something like this with one out, they get the walk and the base hit, now they're all of a sudden the juices are flowing again.
Here's Scott Byers. Ball one.
I said before, the key for Oklahoma, and Larry Koschel was talking about it, was their middle relief. If they could get their middle relief to be effective enough to get the Buckles.
And now Bucky Buckles is throwing in the Sooner bullpen.
He's getting himself right now. Walton is being a little too picky right here. He's trying to be too fine.
This is outside again, and it's now 3-0 to Byers. The designated hitter, Michael Sorrow, was on deck. That's Jason Veritek at third, and Brandon Hensley over at first. 3-0 pitch. Bases are loaded. Take a walk to the mound.
Well, you know what Vern's going to say to him right here. If he doesn't make a change, he's going to go out and just say to him,
I'm going to make a change if you don't.
Yeah, keep the ball down. Yeah, that's right. If you don't do what I tell you, we're going to get you out of here. But they need the ball down in the zone to try to get a ground ball here to turn a double play if they can. But Walton's gotten himself into some trouble here. He walked Veritek. Yeah, I can understand being careful, but there was nobody on base. Five-run lead, it kind of just escalated from there. The walks can really do damage.
Well, after Peyton flied out to center, Veritek walked, Hensley singled, and Byers has now walked to load the bases. In the bullpen with 13 saves to his credit is Bucky Buckle. Georgia Tech dugout after this one.
Oh, a nice swing. Kept his head down, ball out over the plate. They were trying to get the ball down. They got it reasonably down, but that was a good piece of hitting. And here comes Georgia Tech. That's what you worry about. This you can't take it. What did Yogi say? It ain't over till it's over.
You got to figure Mike Sorrow was thinking right along with Vern Rule as he went out to the mound and look for something right over the plate. Now here comes Larry Koschel, and that'll be it for Tim Walton. It's Oklahoma 7, Georgia Tech 4, and Bucky Buckles is on his way to the mound. Here's Michael Smith.
We talked to this kid Buckles yesterday, and he was telling us that he throws a fastball, slider, and a knuckleball. And we said, a knuckleball for a relief pitcher like this? And he said, yeah, occasionally he uses a knuckleball.
Hard down to third, and the play to the plate by Mariani. And the runner is finally out, and the throw back to second. The runner dives back.
Wow, that was close to being real dangerous. Didn't quite run the catcher for us, didn't quite run him back far enough, and they ended up having the pitcher in the middle of it. And on the tag, you'll watch on the tag, he almost drops the ball. The ball's almost knocked out of Buckles' hands. Now watch this, he has to jump to make the play, and the ball almost comes out of his hand.
So Byers is out. Smith reaches on the fielder's choice. He's at first. Sorrow is at second, and here's Matt Sayre. Two out now with runners at first and second. Direct one. Michael's the kind of pitcher who just goes right after hitters.
That's what it looks like. I'm anxious to see now what his breaking ball looks like. He came at him with fastballs to start with, and now I venture to say you'll probably see the slider right here. Well, if it was a slider, it was a little one, but he painted the outside corner. That was a heck of a pitch. Well, that wasn't a slider. They said it was 90 on the radar gun. Now he's got three pitches to work with, and he better get the ball out and away from him here.
There it is. Swinging.
There it is. Quick breaking ball.
Flores makes the throw down to first. Buckles comes in and gets the job done. But Georgia Tech puts two more on the board. We'll go to the last of the sixth. Sooners, 7. Yellow Jackets, 4.
Children's bodies are unique, amazing machines, developing at an incredible rate. They're full of brilliant potential. The Children's Hospital physicians practice specialized medicine using tools and treatments specifically designed for growing bodies. We're helping keep Oklahoma's children alive and well.
Oklahoma with a three-run lead, and both teams with their closers in the lineup now.
Well, that's amazing. That's early in the ball game, but the coaches said that's what they were going to do. I'll tell you, Buckles just did a great job. There were runners at second and third. A base hit there could have had him within a run. Great job of getting out of it.
Top of the Oklahoma batting order. Eric Thomas, Darvin Traylor, Rick Gutierrez to face Chris Myers. That's the first time all day that they've gotten Eric Thomas out. Myers came on in the fourth inning. He has pitched well. Here's Traylor. A triple and an RBI in the first, a ground out in the third, and a walk in the fourth inning. That's called strike. And Myers finally looks to be a little bit more comfortable out on the mound.
He does. I was just looking at him warm up before. He just seemed to relax a little bit. He came into a situation, you know, with two runners on and a 2-0 count and a hitter. That's tough. Actually, the bases were loaded when he came in, 2-0 count.
Came in, completed a walk, which forced in a run, struck out a hitter, then hit another, and then since then has retired 5 straight.
You see now he's got a good split finger to go with a live fastball.
There's a base hit in the right center. Traylor, his second hit of the day. 8 hits now for Oklahoma.
Coach Koschel was telling me yesterday that Traylor can really hit. And he's one of those guys who was drafted last week in the Major League Draft. He's got a nice looking stroke.
It's the problem once you get to Omaha, everybody's got a nice looking stroke.
You're right, or they wouldn't be here. You're right.
To the right side, base hit. Gutierrez hitting behind the runner. Traylor will go from first to third. And the Sooners threaten again with runners at first and third and one out here in the sixth.
Greg, that was another nice piece of hitting. I don't know if that was intentional or not, or if that's the way he hits the ball. I haven't seen him play enough, but that was a nice piece of hitting right there.
Dropped the right foot back. It looks like it
was
intentional.
I'll tell you what, he was trying to do that. You're right. See a guy hit like that, that really shows an unselfishness, a team player, kind of a player that can, he's probably, as we talked yesterday, rather than a number three hitter, probably a kind of two hitter who can handle a bat, shoot the ball the right side, run well. That was nice hitting.
Gutierrez runs well at first. Let's see if he tests Veritek. There he goes. This one hit deep to right field. And way out of here.
Well, we talked about it. The guy was... I'll tell you, the thing about it, we knew he had the ability to do that. That thing might have taken a windshield out behind those bleachers. But did you see him stand there and watch it? He knew he got all of that one.
Damon Miner, 3-run homer, 10-4, Oklahoma.
Well, we were talking about it the last at bat. If they made a mistake with this big guy, he could take it deep. Look at this. Low and inside. He lifts the leg and bang, he gets extension. That thing is really hit. See, all these replays show the same happening. Boy, he got the head of the bat out on that one.
Far beyond the bleachers in right.
He and his brother are from a small town in Oklahoma, and their father is the high school coach of all the sports. That's great to see.
And Myers now has gone 2-0 on shortstop Rich Hill. Damon Miner just did what a DH is supposed to do.
Well, he got all that.
Yeah.
Oh, boy. Hammond, Oklahoma. Have you heard of Hammond? H-A-M-M-O-N?
Not lately, no.
Well, I'll tell you what, when he and his brother get finished, you might be hearing more of it.
Plate count is even at 2 balls and 2 strikes.
Now the ball he hit on Thursday that went so far out was foul. And that one he knew was fair. He hit that son of a gun and stood there and admired that. I guess if I ever hit one like that, I'd admire it too.
Take pictures.
Yes.
Notes.
Except,
the dirt.
Except in my day and age, you stood there and watched it. The next time you came up, you'd be looking at something right between the eyes.
In your day and age, that would happen anyway, wouldn't it?
Yeah, probably. That's right.
So Hills is down on strikes, and that's the first time he's been retired today. Two out, nobody on base, and here's Chip Glass. Shane McGill is the right-hander throwing for Georgia Tech.
Well, we wondered when we saw that Myers only had 2 days rest after pitching 4 innings. Just wonder how far a guy can go.
That one is hit hard.
Georgia Tech's supposed to be the powerhouse here with a home run ability. Oklahoma's just smacked two of them.
Chip Glass had one home run all last season. This is his third in this College World Series. His sixth of this season. Mr. Torborg, you know, you've seen some shots today.
You're not kidding. And you know, it's amazing. Check his bat out and show, and look how far up he chokes the bat. You don't think a guy that chokes a bat up that far will drive a ball. But he definitely has.
Another big inning for the Sooners. Ball strike to Ryan Miner.
That's such a big inning, Greg, because the emotional side of things, you know, it looked like Georgia Tech had just jumped back into this ball game, and all of a sudden, they get blasted.
With 11 runs, the Sooners are now approaching the record for a championship game. Most runs scored by one team. Minnesota beat Arizona 12-1 back in 1956.
That's amazing to watch a guy choking the bat out almost to where you put the pine tar. He's got 3 of their 5 home runs in the College World Series. One was inside the Parker, though.
2-2 now. Mariani takes a look at it. The count is pulled out. 3 balls and 2 strikes.
Mariani's a nice side story in this thing, too, being sick. I'm sure the kid worried all night. Am I going to be able to play? And in between the time he was feeling terrible. Got a base hit, walk. On the count to 3-2 here, he's really contributed.
Oh, is at the plate.
Big base hit, 2 RBI base hit. That was a base hit that had that controversial call on the play at the plate. Plate. Yeah, with Glass scoring.
He hits this one like a bullet into center field.
know, he might be changing his diet from now on.
If he's superstitious.
Shrimp primavera for all my friends.
That's right.
So Mariani on at first with two out, and here's Ryan Miner, the eighth man to come to the plate for Oklahoma in this inning.
Yeah, let's see if this brother can one-up his other, the other brother.
We played that in our house.
Did you?
You break a dish, I break a dish.
Oh, my. Tell you, if that happened in our house, then I was one-upping the three brothers that were there.
Oklahoma 11, Georgia Tech 4. Ball count is now 0-2.
This brother Ryan Miner is also one of their pitchers. Eric Michelle yesterday was saying that he's a 90 plus thrower, and of course you mentioned earlier in the game that he has come out of basketball and has joined them late, and of course it's the latter part of the season that he's been playing first base for him. He's so good defensively.
He got him swinging, but two home runs here in the inning, including one by Chip Glass, and at the end of six, seven.
Did you know home appliance and major system breakdowns cost homeowners an average of $1,700 per year in repairs and replacements?
American Residential Warranty can help cover those costs with home service plans starting at less than a dollar a day.
Plan options include coverage for central air, heat, and ductwork,
interior electrical systems and plumbing,
major kitchen appliances,
water heaters,
washers and dryers,
garage door openers,
ceiling fans, and more,
even pools and spas.
American Residential Warranty replaced my dishwasher with a brand new one, and I only paid a small service fee.
I woke up on a Saturday morning. There was no hot water in the shower. So I called American Residential Warranty. They sent a repairman to fix the problem the same day.
Call now. There's no obligation. But hurry, if you wait until you need a home service repair,
it'll be too late.
Call now to get your home warranty. 1-800-967-9479. That's 1-800-967-9479.
Back to Omaha, top of the seventh inning. Georgia Tech will send to the top of the order. Garcia Parra, McIntyre, and Payton. And that young man, if anybody gets on, Jason Veritek. Oklahoma 11, Georgia Tech 4. Garcia Parra, a single, a homer, and a ground out. Swings on the first pitch, lines at the center. Glass is there.
That's what a coach and a manager likes to see. Buckles came right at him. They just scored big, had a 7-run lead. He's not going to mess around. He went right at him, make them hit their way on. He's another one of their California boys from Victorville.
Here's Scott McIntyre. Stands in at 0-for-3 today.
The only reason I say that, I was talking with him yesterday, and I wasn't sure where that was, and there's a minor league club there in the High Desert. They've done very well.
Word comes up from downstairs that Bucky is averaging right around 90 on the radar gun.
Well, you ought to watch the way the catcher throws the ball back to him about 92. That's interesting to watch.
Rich Hills called off by Eric Thomas. Hills looked like he lost it.
Yeah, I think he did. He lost it and he turned around to yell him to take it that he couldn't see it.
And Thomas came on to make the catch. Two up and two gone, and here's Jay Payton, who's 1-for-3. We have seen four home runs hit here today. That is the most in a College World Series championship game.
Well, we might see some more before it's over, too. Ball is jumping today. Yeah, when you think about this young guy with 20 home runs, 120 some hits, and over 100 RBIs, that's awesome.
435 batting average. Choppers, Hills, Didcock. Second time today he's used that wrong foot throw to first, and they go in order here in the top of the seventh. We'll return to Omaha after this message from your local station.
Making good choices on the go is easy at Taco Mayo. And right now, the best way to get fresh is the Little Big Bowl Combo. Choose the Mexicali Cilantro Lime or Ensalada Little Big Bowl Combo. All less than 450 calories with a Diet Coke and all just $6. There's no fresher Mexican than Taco Mayo. So get fresh today.
Welcome back to Omaha. Oklahoma 11, Georgia Tech 4. We go to the bottom of the seventh inning and a new pitcher on for Georgia Tech. Freshman right-hander Shane McGill.
You know, I was looking at his numbers, Greg. He's 9 wins, 9-4 this year. He's second in all-time wins for a freshman pitcher at Georgia Tech. That'll be a big thrill for a freshman coming out here.
Javi Flores leads it off. He'll be followed by Eric Thomas and Darvin Traylor. Oklahoma with big innings in the fourth and the sixth. A ball and two strikes now. 21,503 on hand here today. That is a new College World Series single game attendance record. They love this game here in Omaha.
They really support this beautiful.
We're having a beach ball removed from the outfield. And we're ready to go now. Pretty happy attitude on the Oklahoma bench. Down to third. Kinsley to Byers out number one. And to the top of the order, and Eric Thomas now.
We were talking earlier. I'm watching Flores run off the field and thinking about the job he's done. Larry Koschel was saying that earlier in the year, the Oklahoma State had stolen an unbelievable number of bases against his ball club, and they put the young kid in behind the plate. He stabilized the team, and he's made a big impact here today.
We talked about Bucky Buckles and his knuckleball. And remember I asked, is it a big-time knuckler? And he said, yeah, why doesn't he throw it more often as well? Because Javi Flores is just a freshman, and he's playing out of position. He may not be able to handle it.
Yeah, that knuckleball is tough. And of course, you're talking about a reliever who very often is in very tight situations. That poor young catcher is just learning the position, is now starting to see a knuckleball. If I were the catcher, I'd be calling fastballs and sliders myself.
There's a shot in the left center field. Eric Thomas' third hit today. Here's Darvin Traylor. That's strike one.
Be interesting to see. I don't know how they work it in a college game, whether they pull in the reins and stop running guys when there's a 7-run lead in the seventh inning. In the major leagues, you start running guys in this situation, all of a sudden the hitters start going down. But I don't know. You know, the philosophy of do we have enough runs, especially with aluminum bat situation, whether they would continue to run. He hasn't made any effort at this point, but it's interesting to see.
Ball on a strike. There he goes. Center base hit. Thomas around on his way to third. Runners at first and third. And one out. And Oklahoma isn't done yet. Let's check in with Leslie Visser. Leslie.
Greg, the major leagues have had to wait for Rick Gutierrez. He was drafted last year by Milwaukee, but he came back to Oklahoma to get his degree. He grew up in a barrio in Los Angeles, was in a gang until he was 14 years old. He said baseball turned him around. Here he is. He's going to graduate, Greg.
Nice trade, Rick.
You're not kidding. How about the teacher that put him in the baseball class? We saw something in the paper about that. That was great. You know, as you go along in your life, and especially with teachers, sometimes you never understand Well, realize how many lives you teach, touch, I should say, and it's hard to measure. Well, you can measure the one that touched this young man's life.
Gutierrez, a base hit to center field, and it's run number 12 for Oklahoma. That throw came in from center field. No one was paying attention to second base. It came all the way through to Jason Veritek. That ties the College World Series record for most runs scored in a game.
You know, it's interesting, too, that as good as Oklahoma has been, one of their best players has not been with them. And it's amazing that you have a guy who was drafted quite high. I guess he was going, Mr. Whitaker was drafted in what? The
second round
yes. By the White Sox. And they're without one of the top players in the game, and they're still this successful.
I should clarify that 12 runs most in a championship game in the College World Series. And here is Mr. Minor, who hit one a long ways with two on back in the sixth inning. Now Damon Minor is going to be lifted for a pinch hitter. Chris Bradshaw is going to come on and hit for Damon Minor. Damon Minor. Job well done by that young man.
Well, I guess. I enjoyed watching him take batting practice. That's fun to watch the ball jump off a kid's bat like that. You know, I think Larry Koschel is doing what good coaches always try to do, get all the kids they can into this game. Of course, I get so nervous, I wouldn't do it till there were two outs of the ninth, but I can see what he's doing. And I'll tell you who appreciates, not just the players, but the parents of those kids, too.
Bradshaw is a senior. He's hitting 206 with a home run and 8 runs batted in. That one goes all the way back to the backstop, and the runners will move up. And that'll go as a wild pitch.
You know, Greg, as you and I were coming out in the car today, we were talking about how tough it is to see either of these teams lose. I mean, that sounds kind of silly when you're talking about a competitive team sport, but they both had such great years. They're both undefeated in the College World Series coming into this.
For Georgia Tech, it has been particularly frustrating over the years. They have been one of the fine college baseball programs in the country, and yet something always happened to them in the regional. This is their first trip to Omaha.
Yeah, it can be tough. You know what else is sad, too, on a day like this? You got a lot of guys who are playing the last game they'll ever play. And we were talking yesterday, boys, for an example, and I'm sure girls, too, but boys think so much about it. They want to first be a cowboy and then a fireman and then a Major League Baseball player. And they play all through all the leagues and spend all this time, and then they come to the end of the road. Not every one of these guys is going out to play professional baseball. And it can be a sad moment that it's the last chance that they'll really be in this type of competition.
Two balls, two strikes to Chris Bradshaw. Outside, the count is full. The Tech infield playing in to cut off any further damage.
Yeah, they can't give up any more runs than this. They've got an awful deep hole to get out of now. You know, you talk about coaches and managers giving players a chance. I remember Walter Alston didn't have to, but he put me in New York City in front of my mother and dad, and my wife was expecting our first child on our first anniversary, and I got my first major league hit. And Walter did it on purpose to allow me to play in front of my parents. And I tried to do that as a manager later on, bring players in and give them shots to play. And a lot of people don't realize you're doing that.
That's ball four, and the bases are loaded. Incidentally, the 16-run score here today also ties a College World Series championship game record for most runs in a game by two teams. Michael Smith in the outfield.
It's
tell you what.
Retrieving bunches of stuff.
Now, wait a minute. There have been a lot of errors in the game, but I've never seen a vendor drop his stuff over the fence.
Here's Rich Hill with the bases loaded. Darvin Traylor is at third. Rick Gutierrez at second. And Chris Bradshaw leading off first. Bases loaded, one out, 1-0 the count to Hill. A looper, and it'll drop. Bases will remain loaded, 13-4 Oklahoma. And that tells you when things are going badly. I mean, that's a pretty good pitch McGill threw.
Hey, that's an aluminum bat hit right there. That ball stuck to the handle and just kind of, he kind of flipped it out to left field. If that's a wood bat, he's holding about 2 inches of bat in his hand. The ball doesn't get past the infield.
And Veritek goes to the mound now. Seeded teams. Things remain the way they are. Fourth seed Oklahoma would join the list. And again, you come to Omaha and you say, oh no, I don't want to be a number one or a two or a number three. Give it to somebody else.
Well, that's seeding. How far can you go with that? When you get to Omaha, the eight best teams in the country at that point.
Shot towards short. To second for one. To first. Double play. Gets him out of the inning. But not before a little more damage was done. Seven innings complete in the championship game here in Omaha with the Oklahoma Sooners very much in control.
Okay. So you're a working adult and thinking about going back to school, but you feel it might be out of reach. Fortunately, there's the University of Oklahoma Outreach, a continuing education program for working adults like you, meaning you can get a degree online and in the classroom with options including nights and weekends. Give your career that credible boost it needs with a reputable degree at a realistic price. Your degree is within reach with OU Outreach. Apply today at OUOutreach.org.
You know, we were just watching batting practice yesterday, watching him turn from the right side to the left side. And as often happens, even though the right side is his natural side, from the left side, he seems to swing the bat with a little different look. Now, here he is right-handed in that big home run.
And then on the other side of the plate.
Now, you can see he's different from the left side. Left side, he's spread out more and open a little bit. Right side, he stands upright. And a lot of that has to do with, as a right-handed hitter, he looks like he's a better high ball hitter, which is kind of natural with most hitters. And left-handed, looks like he likes the ball down more, and he's a little open.
He has homered and walked twice today, one of them intentional. And that one up and away, 2-1.
What a career is that, though? You know, when you realize that this guy turned down a lot of money last year to come back to school and a lot of pressure on him and has had an even better year.
Boy, he gets up there cutting, doesn't he?
He does.
Selected 14th overall in the first round by the Seattle Mariners. A three-time All-American.
How many of those have you ever heard of? Three-time All-American catchers.
There's a shot to center field. So Veritek is on. This year's All-America team has Jason Veritek behind the plate. Paul Wilson, the number one pick overall by the New York Mets out of Florida State, made the trip here.
Jose Cruz Jr. That's Jose Cruz, the left-handed hitter that's great major leaguer. That's his son. Had a great year.
There's a chopper toward Hill. It's a second for one. The first double play. It has been a record-setting year for double plays for the Oklahoma Sooners. That is a record 80th in this, their 67th game. The old team record back in 1976, they turned 65 in 81 games.
Mm-hmm. I'll tell you, when you have sound defense and you have team speed the way they have, those are two constants you bring to the ballpark every day. Whether the opposition pitcher is tough, whether you're swinging the bat well or swinging in bad luck, you still have your solid defensive B, that thing that you can say, hey, I know I've got that today.
In the batter's box now for Georgia Tech is Tucker Barr, number 29. He is a sometime catcher, sometime pitcher.
Yesterday when we were talking to Danny Hall, they said if they needed a closer today down late in the game, that they would bring him in. And that's interesting because he is the heir apparent to Veritek behind the plate as well. So this kid's a talented kid. We watched him take batting practice yesterday. He's got a lot of pop.
He's a 275 hitter with no home runs this year, 16 runs batted in. Been a dry spell for the Big 8 Conference, hasn't it?
Sent some good teams here in the meantime.
One fouled. And it's a full count of 3-2.
Oklahoma sent some good teams here in the past, too. I remember a team that was led by Bob Shirley, left-handed pitcher that eventually ended up with the Yankees. He came in here. George Fraser was a pitcher on that club, too, major league pitcher.
Ball four and bars on.
They had a club that I saw play against the University of Arizona one time. The first team I've ever seen, they were all left-handed hitters. The whole team was left-handed.
And now number 26, Tucker Barr's brother, Matt Barr, steps to the plate to hit for Michael Sorrow. So Danny Hall doing the same thing.
Yep. And of course we talked earlier, Leslie did a thing about Matt Barr graduating today. And I think he's going to law school.
Matt Barr, 196 hitter, no home runs, 6 runs batted in. And now we're going to get a pinch runner at first base. Jimmy Lincoln, number 24, will run for Tucker Barr.
Jimmy Lincoln's a good football player for Georgia Tech as well, a good running back.
There's a drive into right center field, and that'll go maybe for extra bases. Lincoln to third, no. Barr is going to hold at first. So runners at first and third and two out. Never mind. Base hit left field. Michael Smith with the RBI single. And it's now 13-5. That one throw, I thought for golfers, that was an easy one.
It was, but I'm not a golfer. Oh. Did you see me hit all those years? I wasn't going to be frustrated when that was over either.
How many times have you played the game?
Once.
We're dead even.
That's all right. One time, and I didn't make it more than 3 or 4 holes.
Oh, in that case, I'm ahead of you. And now Ryan Ritter steps to the plate. He'll hit for Matt Sayre. So Ryan Ritter at the plate, 2 on and 2 out. Ritter hitting 299 with 8 home runs and 32 runs batted in. And Oklahoma kind of being thankful for that double play ball earlier in the season.
Sure are. Pitchers are always happy when that happens behind them. I think it's their best friend, probably.
Ritter fouls it back and is down the count now. No balls, 2 strikes.
Let's see if he can hit this slider here. Talking to Bucky yesterday, he talked about that was his out pitch, and that's what he struck, I think it was, he struck out earlier in the game on after he got ahead of him, but let's see if they call it here.
Was Matt Sayre here?
Was it Sayre? Okay.
Yep, there it is.
Or Sayer in the dugout, Ritter hitting for Sayer. Still no balls and two strikes to pinch hitter Ryan Ritter. Oklahoma 13, Georgia Tech 5. The Sooners 13 runs, 16 hits and no errors. Tech 5 runs, 9 hits, 4 costly errors. Back in Omaha, numerous changes now on defense for Georgia Tech. Number 31, Carlos Quezon is the new pitcher. Adam Easterling is out in left field. Left fielder Michael Smith has moved to right. Third baseman Brandon Hensley has moved to first. And Ryan Ritter has moved in at third base. You got that, Jeff?
Yeah.
MJ Mariani. What an adventure the last 12 to 16 hours has been for him.
That is, isn't it?
Food poisoning, up all night, showed up weak at the ballpark, questionable for the game. Not only has played, but has played well.
It's been a big contributor.
A walk and two hits. A couple of RBI, one ball and one strike. Quezon goes 2-1.
You know, Greg, sitting here and watching Veritek catch, it makes me think about guys staying in school and going to college rather than signing. And you talk about Matt Barr, for an example, graduating, wasn't even in his graduation, but here he is going to law school from here. You can see, it looked like he broke his hands on that one. But it makes you think about the kid who is not a real early round draft choice by the big leagues, and it may be even those guys, to go to school and have that degree to fall back on is so important.
I bet it is, and I'll bet the guys who have gone on and done that would echo that 1,000 times. Mark Soto, number 22, now steps in to hit for Ryan Miner.
You know, there are a lot of extenuating circumstances that are involved in things like that, and high round draft choice and signing after your junior year. But my three boys, all two of them were drafted out of high school, and they went on to college, one to North Carolina, one to Duke and Columbia, and then the one who will graduate next week from Northwestern. I am so glad that they went to college. I just think it's great. My oldest boy pitched for 4 years in the minor leagues and hurt his elbow. If he hadn't had his degree, what was he going to do? And I think that's... When you look out here, you just think this is, you know, the end of the line for a lot of guys. But the college throughout the college baseball is just great.
Fastball is up high. A ball and two strikes now to Soto. We are in the bottom of the eighth inning. Oklahoma jumped out to a 2-0 lead in the first inning. Georgia Tech tied it on solo home runs in the second and the third, but then five runs in the bottom of the fourth sent Oklahoma on their way, and their strike three call on Soto. That looks like a good looking pitch. Ah, that looks a little low from there.
If I'm the hitter, I think it's a ball. If I'm the catcher, I want it.
Javier Flores. On 1-for-4 afternoon. And Quezon misses that 2-0.
You know, it'll be interesting to see where
where Larry Koschel plays Javi next year, because he's losing Hills, going to sign, and wonder if he'll be back in the infield.
That's a strike. Well, it'll be a time to determine if Javi Flores really wants to be a catcher.
Yes.
Foul back. If he jumps at the opportunity to play shortstop, you know his heart really isn't in it.
Really? Well, you know, it's amazing. It's the position is, and I'm prejudiced in saying this, the position is so important to a ball club. You might go 0-for-4, but the way you call a game, the way you block balls in the dirt, keeping runners from advancing, very often can't be measured, and yet it's so important to a club. I guess it'll be determined on what helps the club most.
Javier bounces it towards second. Flip for one. Garcia Parra with a rocket to first for the double play. Georgia Tech looking at their last licks coming up in the top of the ninth inning, and they're trailing 13-5.
Don't miss the 4th of July celebration at Lucky Star Casino in Concho. Starting at 4 p.m., bring the whole family. Balloon bounces, face painters, balloon artists, and magicians. And one of the largest fireworks displays in Oklahoma at Lucky Star Casino in Concho.
Did you ever lose your keys, ask someone else to help look, and there they are, right in front of you? Well, if you're looking for a job or the right employee, that's why we're here. OklahomaCityHelpWanted.com. Employment is all we do. It's the only thing. We help employers find qualified local candidates. Looking for a job? Post your resume for free. View job listings in your area. We promise it's there, and we can help you find it. OklahomaCityHelpWanted.com. Long name, amazing results.
This Independence Day, come to Lucky Star Casino for Lucky Four Lot Seats. Be here on July 4th from noon to 8 p.m. for your share of $5,000. Lucky Fourth Hot Seats at Lucky Star Casino in Concho, Wetaka, Canton, and the new Travel Center in Concho.
Greg Gumbel along with Jeff Torborg and Leslie Visser and Ron Frazier. And it's a good time to ask you about your impressions now that as we've just about come to the end of this College World Series championship game.
I've always followed it, never been here before. I've been impressed with Omaha, the ballpark, the reception here, and I'll tell you, I've really been impressed with the talent I've seen in these two clubs and of course, the coaching. So the total picture is this is a great showpiece for college baseball.
A lot of talent that is going to be seen in the next few years at the major league level, too.
Oh, I think so. When you look at these two clubs and all told, I guess there were 12 from these two clubs drafted. It'll be interesting to watch these kids as they mature and move through the minor leagues.
Including this young man, Nomar Garcia Parra. Singled in the first, homered in the third, grounded out in the fifth, and flied out in the seventh. Ball one.
You know, we heard Danny Hall talking about Garcia Parra. Garcia Parra, I've had trouble saying that all day. Comparing him to Barry Larkin, I mean, that's a pretty darn good comparison. Barry Larkin's going to find outstanding all-star players in the game and has been for a few years, and he coached him at Michigan. But he likens this youngster to him, and that's really saying something.
One and two now to Garcia Parra.
Yeah, that shot of the dugout there, you can see he's smiling, but it's hurting. They're not feeling real good about this situation at this point. Come this far, they've been working so hard since, well, actually, you know, college baseball nowadays is a year-round project. These kids lift weights when they're not playing. They're taking batting practice. They play fall baseball. It's so different than when you and I played. I mean, we only had one coach, didn't play fall baseball. Played maybe, what, scheduled 23 to 25 games, maybe got five rained out.
I'm just looking at these numbers. At Georgia Tech played, as this is game number 67
right.
of the season. Oklahoma, Georgia Tech comes in at 50-16. Oklahoma comes in at 49-17.
Really?
Chopper. Gutierrez. Good arm.
Greg, I played at Rutgers University, and I wouldn't trade it for anything. I had a great experience and an outstanding coach. Matt Bolger's in the College Coaches Hall of Fame. You look back on those experiences and these kids in those dugouts, even the Georgia Tech bunch that are really downtrodden over this whole thing, they'll be able to look back and they'll never forget what went on. Getting here, the whole experience.
Here's Scott McIntyre. One out in the ninth. Two out in the ninth. Buckles on to Soto at first.
Well, Larry Koschel's game plan with his pitching staff, he did just about what he told us yesterday he was going to try to do. And it's worked for him. Of course, that ugly inning in the fourth just knocked the dickens out of Georgia Tech.
I mentioned to Bucky yesterday, it sounds like Larry Koschel, you're his guy from the sixth inning on, whether you have it or not.
Right.
He said, hope so. Payton with a base hit. And that will give Jason Varitek another shot at the plate.
Well, might be his, probably be his last at bat in college after a magnificent career. Be interesting to see how he finishes it here.
He homered in the second, was walked intentionally in the third, walked again in the sixth, and singled sharply to center field in the eighth inning. And he nubs it in front of the plate. Javi Flores throws it out, and Oklahoma's a champion. Accepting congratulations. Reality sinks in for Georgia Tech. The Oklahoma Sooners have won their second National Collegiate Baseball Championship. 13-5 is the final score. Off of a 16-hit barrage. We talked about how quick Javi Flores was.
Yes. You know, as I look down there, I think about here is a team, Oklahoma, that was unranked in the preseason. And they beat the team that was ranked number one preseason.
Look at that dugout.
Yep.
Just a matter of timing and when you've got to get this thing right and now. little tripping on the way. That can be dangerous.
You've got an ambulance ready after that celebration.
Bucky Buckles gets the save. Oklahoma is a champion. Two in the first, five in the fourth, four more in the sixth inning, two in the seventh. Georgia Tech just never recovered after pulling into a 2-2 tie. Congratulations to the Oklahoma Sooners, national champions.
Special thanks to our cornerstone television partners, Chesapeake Energy, Windstar World Resorts, Anheuser-Busch, OU Outreach, OU Alumni Association, OU Medicine, and the OU President's Associates.
And welcome to Norman and the University of Oklahoma.
In the way where the restaurant has, the dysfunctional part of the restaurant has become into our relationship.
All right, you got your homework. I appreciate your time.
Thank you.
I'll see you tomorrow.
A lot of things happened today, and I'm not sure that they can all be fixed in 2 days and $10,000. That's not going to fix our relationship.
On an all-new Cutthroat Kitchen.
This guy is in the crosshairs.
How's that fit?
A chef gets shackled.
All of a sudden, this got super evil.
But he's got some culinary tricks up his sleeve.
I'm trained to deal with him.
All new Cutthroat Kitchen, Sunday night at 10.
Aging. But that should never keep us from living. Visit Brookdale.com to customize your senior living solution today.
How can a tablet replace your laptop? Start with the best writing experience. Make it incredibly thin. Add an adjustable kickstand, a keyboard, a USB port, and the freedom of touch. And of course, make it run Microsoft Office with the power and speed to do real work. Introducing Surface Pro 3, the tablet that can replace your laptop.
To get the quality of award-winning bottled wine for 40% less, lose the bottle. Award-winning Black Box Wines. 40 gold medals, 40% less expensive than comparable wines.
We love this kitchen.
What's next?
Great. Do you have measurements?
Yep. I pasted it off. It's about 20 by 12 of these.
So we can measure, plan, and install it for you.
Yeah, let's do that.
IKEA. Professional kitchen services at a low price.
Going to college is a big commitment. So when you earn your bachelor's or master's degree at DeVry University or its Keller Graduate School of Management, we promise you care and attention. An education that helps prepare you for a real career. And now, the DeVry University Fixed Tuition Promise. Lock in your tuition rate through graduation. Even if tuition increases year to year, your rate stays the same. That's our